don't care what you do, I'm getting out. No, nothing ever shames me. Don't want a thing from you, I'm going out. I don't care if you're angry. I'm getting out. No, nothing ever shames me. I'm going out. I don't care if you're angry.
Season Surfer Radio. I am your co-host Tyler Brewer,
and I'm your co-host Ben Pomeroy. Tyler, I love that intro music, and you're playing around with new sound effects.
I know. I'm getting all fancy here. You know, we were just listening to Jimmy Eat World, "Get It Faster." This was our guest song for his section in "Momentum Under the Influence" by Taylor Steele. And our guest episode for Swell Season is none other than 1999 Rookie of the Year, 2001 World Champ, Clifton James Hobgood, a.k.a. CJ. Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but that was CJ's first part where he didn't have to share it with his brother Damian in the Taylor film, I believe, as well. So, pretty interesting, and we're stoked that CJ's here. We're going to be diving into their film, And If 2 by C, and the Hobgood documentary, or the Hobgoodementary, if you will. You like that?
I like that. Yeah. I saw that. That was clever. There's a lot of wordplay.
A lot of play on words there. Yeah. Hold on. There, you know. There we go.
That's what I was going to say. The soundboard, I was like, wait for a... you announced my name, I was like... Yeah. I like this.
We're playing with all these new sounds we just got.
Elevating the
production. He doesn't even know what buttons he's hitting.
No, I'm like, what does this do? Oh, we got a little spring going here. Like, camera, all sorts of sounds. No fart ones, though.
No.
Kind of
left
those off. But pretty excited. And Ben, yeah, we're going to have also Justin Purser, director, filmmaker, also. But we're going to keep them separate because they need to be in separate rooms. Otherwise, they're going to fight.
Vinegar.
It's going to be fisticuffs on air. They've been traveling a lot together, so that's why.
I mean, this is a fun... Jesus Christ.
I'm a little slow to it.
All right. There's going to be... this is where I come in as the heavy and hold that hand away from the keyboard.
CJ, welcome to the show.
Yeah, guys. Thanks for having me, man. We're in Brooklyn.
Yeah, man.
Yeah. Yeah, no.
Just to get closer to the mic here.
Get closer to the mic. You want to
hug it.
The mic.
Want to hug it.
So you just we got you and us a pie of pepperoni.
Paulie Gee's.
We got to give props to them. How was it? Like, you know, a lot of our guests come from out of town. They're like, they want to know what the best pizza is. It's a very difficult conversation for us to have.
But everyone has their own favorites, I guess.
Yeah. So how was it?
Yeah, I mean, if it's difficult for you, my palate just goes Brooklyn. I'm in the city. It's better than anything I've ever had, and it just falls into that category. And I'm just not even sophisticated enough to go to where you guys can go to.
Well, let us be your guide.
Yes. Yeah, we could just like
what
start ordering.
Now
start ordering
what
pies.
That essence that you're tasting, that's a bit of the coal from the oven that you're feeling a flavor, but there's some remnants of the Hellboy that they also have.
Yeah, they put
it,
this spicy honey thing on. Was New York a pit stop for you back in the day with like to do events? Like, what is New York in your career? As you headed off to places where there's, you know, real surf.
Well, in the career world, I mean, I don't think it was anything, to be honest. I think for the surfers a lot, it's like, how do I get there? Like, because I know it's hard to wrap in my job, but that's where I want to go. So it's like whether, but for me right now, New York is like food.
and
like shows,
awesome film,
like comedy clubs, yeah. And
date nights with the wife.
Yeah, I mean, that's we come in for the weekend and we do food and we do comedy clubs and just relax.
Yeah,
that's what it is for me right now. And then before that, it was always just like, wow, I got to check this place out.
Right, right.
So, Hobgood, what is that? Is that like, it's not Spanish. I don't think Norwegian either. Is it like, Hobbit or?
I don't even know what it is. You know the wifey did the 23andMe once? She ordered it for me.
Wow.
There was, you know, European, Italian, some French, or some Cherokee. Wow. And then, yeah, I think that was most of it, so.
That's crazy. Does, like, your family, do like, your parents know their lineage at all? Like, kind of, like, is there a story to, like, your family lineage or history? Like, it's a fairly unusual name, and obviously you guys pointed out in the film quite a bit, like, what is a Hobgood is, like, one of the questions that kind of persists throughout it.
I don't know, man. I never got a story, really, for my parents, for the most part. I remember my mom's grandma was, like, looked just super Italian. So, no, my mom's mom was just like, wow, she looks really Italian, you know.
She's got the Roman nose.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
But those studies are so crazy because they can, like, throw a new storyline into how, like, you know, your family. Like, I did one and I was like, I had, like, Balkan. I didn't know that. You know, like, you can be, like, surprised by it.
Yeah, it's funny because, like, they're just... You know, as we continue to go down this road that we're down, you know, they're just sort of mining all this information, yeah. And they're going to just take that to the next stage. And yeah. So, like, I'm waiting for, like, the email to come and, like, now this is what we can find out about you. And yep. I'm just like,
yep.
So
you
it's
get, like
this...
monthly updates, don't you?
Oh, yeah, you got to throw it to the junk mail because they just hammer you, man. Yeah, they send you stuff all the time. So, I don't know. I'm in the system. I don't know what I gave up. I know I gave up like $100 or something. I don't know how much that stuff is. Well, so I gave up money and I gave up. But you know what? I always figured I got a get out of jail free card because my brother's got the same DNA.
Oh, yeah.
So I was always like, dude, if I kill somebody, I got a freaking alibi. It could have been him.
Exactly. Except like, he lives on the West Coast.
But check his DNA. It could have been him. You know? Like,
did you guys ever participate in one of these twin studies, especially, you know, given that you guys are such exceptional athletes, that there was, you know, people wanted to talk to you about that kind of thing?
No. I mean, because when you're living out of an area where you just go, dude, I hate this guy. I want this guy out of here. I want this guy gone. And why is he around? You know? He's taking everything from me. And so... to get out of that mindset and go on a, like a study or like a scavenger hunt like the ways, it's like my brain couldn't even go there.
So you wouldn't consider if someone approached you even like, hey.
Well, now it's different, you know, you're retired and he's got his family, he lives on the West Coast and stuff like that. It would just be like, what are we gonna search for?
Because it's crazy, like apparently identical twins share 99.9% DNA, basically. And a lot of studies have shown, like, twins who were separated at birth, identical twins. And I don't know if you've seen that triplet movie that was, like, on CNN for a while, where they were separated at birth and then found each other
there
randomly.
Was a documentary. It was, like, triplets or something. Yeah, I saw that. That was pretty nuts.
And, like, they were had the same personality, a lot of the same traits. It was really kind of crazy, actually.
Yeah, it is. And this guy made a good point. We premiered in Asbury Park last night, and it was an identical twin. And he's like, oh, my gosh, people come up to me and ask me, like, well, you know, what's it like? And his reply was, like, what's it like to be not a twin?
Yeah.
So it's like, you guys are asking me questions that, like, that's the only lens I know. So
it's
I can't go to lonely. See, I'm glad. It's lonely, but not quite as lonely. I live a less lonelier life as a twin.
My nieces are twins, and they're, like, I think about 14, and they're starting to sort of really differentiate what they're into. But they were, you know, like I assume early on, you guys were wedded at the hip, and like they did this canoeing program this summer, and one of them really loved it. I think she'll be a lifer, and the other was like, no thanks,
off it.
Yeah,
that's so when I look at twins now, that's what I'm looking at. Like, we have my next door neighbor across the street is he's married to a twin. Her twin lives right down the street, and then she just got pregnant, and then I was hitting my wife going, like, I guarantee the other one's going to get pregnant. Yeah. And it's just, like, wow. There's some twins that they're just, like, pushing the stroller. They live close. It's just, like, they never hit that separation point. And so, yeah, that's sort of the study that I do. Okay, their twins are identical. Are they still going parallel paths, or have they just hit the fork in the road?
And in some ways, like, you and your brother have, like... We're very parallel, but have kind of hit a big fork in the road in some ways.
Yeah, so our interests were so the same, it didn't really start happening until, I mean, the proper fork probably didn't happen until we're like, mid to early 30s, which is a long part of your life.
Yeah.
Now we kind of just encourage each other. It's weird.
Yeah.
Like it's gone full circle, man. It's weird how we show up now, because it's just like, oh man, what are you dealing with, and vice versa. And I was like, well, I've been through that before. You'll get through it, like, yeah, you got what it takes.
Well, your brother. I'm probably jumping ahead of all our questions, Ben, but like, I'm curious.
Stay
like,
in order.
It was really interesting. I like looked up your brother on LinkedIn. Not a stalker. Mm-hmm. Just like,
am I on there? Because I signed up at one point.
I didn't look, actually. I didn't have to look, because I knew what you did for a living. Like, I know you worked at Salty Crew. And
what did you say my brother did?
Well, he works at the he makes the valves.
Yeah, he sells pressure valves.
Pressure valves for, like, everything from medical equipment to plumbing to whatever. He's a rep, basically.
Yeah, so anything that has pretty much a gas, I guess, or a valve that has pressure, he'll sell it.
It's brilliant. Like, it's so niched. That, it seems like the type of market that you don't have to worry about outside coming in so much. Like, you're so specialized that you just have a lock on customers to a certain extent.
But it's real good old boy stuff, so you're right. It is niche. There's a lock, and he just has a great boss.
Really?
I love my boss. But, dude, he just tells me story after story. He's like, I can't even get through the receptionist. Like, I can't even break through. I'm like... Dude, you travel the world your whole life and you can't get through the receptionist. Come on, kid, But that's, that's part of
that's because he has he has the drawl, whereas you're much more succinct with your speaking. Like, Damo's got the kind of thing going.
Yeah, they don't know what he's talking about, probably first. They need some subtitles, and they're like, can you get to your point?
I love in the film how they, like, you guys jump all over that right out of the gate, the difference of how you guys speak.
We saw the film. Just because I'm a jury member on the London Surf Film Festival, I got a screener.
Nice.
That's how I got it, by the way.
That's how we got in here.
Yeah. So one of the things I thought was really interesting is, like, you're going back and revisiting your life with this film. Like, one was, like, I thought it was really interesting how you went back to the high school and, like, what was it like hearing your teachers talk about you? And do you remember them looking fondly on you when you were in school as opposed to after and all your achievements? Is it weird? Like, I don't know. Like, I have not gone back to my teachers or anything. And I imagine, like, I don't know if, like, you had angst towards your teachers or really liked them, and then hear them talking about you in such a fond way, and you're like, oh, no, you were such a prick to me, actually.
It was an experience,
because
obviously things when you're a kid seem really big.
Yeah.
And then so when you go to back to those places, you're like, this isn't that big, And but for... I think for us, it was like a lot of those people that we are by that time or that point in our life, it was just like, how do I become teacher's pet? How do I make my life as easy as possible so I can go surf, so I can get out of here? However I need to stroke them, however I need to do that to make that happen, that's my goal.
Yeah.
The light bulb for me with school it turned on later, like, where I was just like, oh, I know how to, this is a system.
Yeah.
And I know how to make my mom happy in the system so I can do what I want. And that was like fourth or fifth grade when that sort of light bulb turned on. And then, so it was funny. One of the teachers was like, they were like, and they knew how to get away with just what they wanted. And I was like, wow, this teacher was